We're going to start the program as the last few tables are served. So if I could direct your attention to the stage just for the next 45 minutes or so. Shh. Welcome again this evening. I first talked to Joey about this several months ago. He said he'd think about it. He actually said, do you think anybody's going to remember me or care by then? And then he said he'd think about it till after the election, and he finally said he was game. And so when we first started moving forward with the organization of tonight, we realized it was kind of late in the year. We weren't quite sure that you know, there'd be budgets allowing people to buy tables and to make it a successful event. So we worked on a really, really tight budget. And I asked him then, I said, well, do you want to make it a fundraiser, Joey? Because there are certain ways you structure events if the goal is for fundraising. I said, maybe we could raise some money for the Durel Oak or a memorial sign at the horse farm, at the farmer's market at the horse farm or something like that. And in typical modesty, he said, no, that's, you know, let's not do that. So we announced it very late in the game, and we weren't really sure how successful it would be. So I just want to thank everybody for coming, because it's a very special evening for this community, I think, and for Joey. So thank y'all so much. I want to thank all of our sponsors. Of course, we did structure it so there could be some table sponsors who could maybe sign up early and help us make sure that we would have the budget to do this. So Allen and Gooch, we want to thank Allen and Gooch for being a table sponsor, DSF Wealth Management, the Glenn Armentor Law Corporation, Southern Lifestyle Development, Sides and Associates, the Southwest Group, and Van Eaton and Romero. Those are our table sponsors, so please give them a round of applause. But of course, we couldn't have even started this without the support of Iberia Bank. Many of you are familiar with the lecture series excuse me, that we do every year. And so we thought we had blown our whole budget on the stump speech, honestly, but it turned out that our clever new accountant at our office had tucked a little away, because we had talked at the beginning of the year about having a fourth event, and so lo and behold, we found out that we had at least the seed money to get this started. And I just want to say, this is the 13th year, I believe, of the lecture series. Iberia signed on at the very beginning. It's been a great partnership. We've brought some tremendous speakers into this community to cover a broad range of topics. This was our most ambitious year yet, though. The stump speech, for those of you who were able to come, it darn near killed me to try to pull all those details together, but it turned out to be a great event, thanks in part to Iberia, AT&T, and all of our media partners who stepped up to help with that. And tonight was pretty ambitious, too, especially to pull this together around the holidays. But please, help me give a really warm thank you for Iberia Bank and the ongoing partnership that they have with this. So, as I said, this wasn't created to be a fundraiser, but early on we realized that ticket sales were going pretty well and sponsorship sales were going pretty well. And so we decided that if there were any proceeds over and above expenses, that we wanted to use them to make a donation to something, and we knew that the park at the horse farm would be the appropriate charity. So while this wasn't envisioned to be a fundraiser, it has turned out to be one in a lot of ways, and I'm going to walk through real quickly what happened. So we contacted E.B. Brooks a few weeks ago and said, you know, it looks like we're going to squeeze out a little money, and we're going to be able to write a check to the horse farm for about $3,000. And Evie said, well, that's great, because it's actually going to be $6,000 through the generosity of Kip and Carolyn Schumacher, because and Kip can't be with us tonight, but Carolyn's here. The offer, the very generous offer that they've made, is for anybody who makes a donation to the horse farm between now and the end of the year, and I believe I have this right, EB, they will match it up to $500,000. So for any of you who may be using end of the year planning, It's a great way to parlay that gift into double the money. So then tonight I was sharing that story with Judy Terzotis, who's going to be here on the stage a little bit later with Gannett. And Judy says, well, we'll match your $3,000 from the Gannett Foundation. So actually tonight's event is going to generate $12,000 for the horse farm. So I'd like Judy and Carolyn and Lenny Lemoyne to come up on stage, and we'll make a symbolic check donation. But it's really thanks to all of you that all this got started. So thank you so much. So Judy and Carolyn and Lenny.
Those of you that know me know that I can't resist the opportunity to say something. But I do want to thank Cherry and Steve for all that you do to support our community, and certainly for this event this evening, and, you know, for your contribution to our park. You mentioned the match by Carolyn and Kip. We also have a board member who has grown that match to $1 million. And so I want to thank, you know, Carolyn and Kip for their commitment to our park, and in all of our donors in the final stage of this phase one campaign. We have $2 million left to raise to be able to start construction out there in phase one. These guys have put up $1 million, so we really need, you know, people in our community, all of us, to step up and take advantage of this challenge. It's a great opportunity. I have a young lady sitting at my table tonight who I'd never met, that I think speaks to the importance of this park. Her name is Marissa Collins, and I asked her, I said, where are you from? She said, I'm from New Jersey. I said, well, how'd you get to Lafayette? She said, well, I married a young man from Lafayette, and I moved to New Orleans because I wanted to come to Louisiana because of the food, but, you know, wasn't interested in necessarily moving to Lafayette. But she said, when you guys announced the park, we decided to move to Lafayette. She said, that's what got us here. So, you know, Joey, you have been a tremendous advocate of this park from the beginning. It would not be a reality without you. And I think that when you hear from people like Marissa, it hopefully makes you understand how this is one of the many great accomplishments that we've been able to enjoy during your time as our leader. So thank you very much for your leadership, and thank all of you for your support of our park.
Thank you, Lenny. And one more note before I introduce our MC for the evening, Don Bakke. We did not intend for this to be on the same night as a council meeting. The original night we picked was tomorrow night, but there were several people that we wanted to be part of the program who couldn't make it for tomorrow night. So I called Joey and I said, can we do it on Tuesday instead? And he said, well, let me look at my calendar. And he looked at his calendar and he said, oh, I'm free that night. Let me check with Lynn. So he called me back and he said, yeah, that's going to work just fine. And then about 2 days later, he called me back and I could see him like a deer in the headlights through the phone. And he said, that's my last council meeting. And I said, too late. The invitations have gone out. They've been printed. We got the double tree booked. And I guess you'll just have to skip out early. So that's why it's on the night of a council. We did invite all the council to be here, but I think the meeting's running a little long, as they do sometimes. But anyway, we're ready to get the roast started, and please help me welcome Don Bakke to get things off.
Thank you, Cherry, and thank all of you all for being here tonight. You know, every once in a while, we honor a politician that deserves it. A man of integrity, of talent, sincerity, intelligence. Unfortunately, it's not me tonight. Someone like me, though. Unfortunately, as I said, tonight's not the time. Instead, we bid adieu to Joey Durel. And to paraphrase Shakespeare, we come here tonight to say goodbye to Joey, not to praise him. We all know Joey. And when I was thinking about how to describe him, I thought to myself that history is replete with the names of simple men who are best remembered for their simple phrases. People like Joey, Yogi Berra, Henny Youngman, Donald Trump. And now we can add Joey to that list of simple people. Over the past 12 years, his simple thoughts have become legendary. And tonight we will surely revisit some of them. My involvement with Joey began about 13 years ago. We were at a chamber seminar, and Joey informed me of his desire to run for mayor president, the office that he will soon vacate. It was rumored at the time that I might be interested in that office, and so he wanted to make sure of my intentions so that we wouldn't be running against each other. And instead, I told him, Joey, I'm not going to run. I'm going to help you. As you know, Joey was declaring his candidacy to replace Walter Como, who was considered at that time by most people to be unbeatable. But being a simple person, that didn't deter Joey. In fact, this is the best of all. He visited with Walter and Glenn Weber, who was his opponent in the election, visited with them and said that he was interested in running to replace Walter, and it was rumored that Walter might not run. And if that were true, Joey wanted to know if Walter would endorse him. Now think about this. What do you think Walter and Glenn Weber spoke about after Joey left that meeting? I can only imagine that conversation. But people like Joey aren't deterred by those who might stand in their way. They're focused on the task at hand, winning an unwinnable election. He'd recruited me, and soon he added to his team, and they're here tonight. I saw them, Bill Fenstermaker, Clay Allen, and you're going to hear from Gary McGoffin later. His volunteer staff, and he hired Ben Berthelot. Ben at that time was kind of a hippie. In fact, he still is. But he hired Ben Berthelot as his only paid staff, and then he hired Bob Munson as the consultant to run the campaign. And then he set off on his quixotic quest. To show how inconceived that quest was, we have a copy of an email that was sent to me by Cherry and Steve May just as they were planning to move back to Lafayette. The last sentence says it all. Is he insane? No, just simple. But others have recollections as well, and to begin the night, we're going to start with Gary McGoffin. I don't know where Joey is.
Right here. Would you raise your hand? Okay, good, 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 good.
I see the light blinking off of his head.
Good evening. It's great to be here. I met Joey in the Boy Scouts. We were in the same scout troop. He was about a year behind me, and still is. And he only lasted about a year. But it was a really good year, and he learned one of the lessons that you learn in scouting, which is to leave your campsite better than you find it. And trustworthy, loyal, helpful, all of those good things. We next got together in the Chamber of Commerce. Joey was chairman of the chamber. I was new to the chamber. And a theme that he's had throughout his term in office here with Lafayette Consolidated Government is let's run it like a business. And he did that as the chamber chair and decided that for his executive committee, he wanted his vice president of technology to be a lawyer. Run it like a business. We found out that actually the business of technology is much harder than technology itself. So we renewed our acquaintance then. It was wonderful. He stepped down after 2001, ushered the last school tax through to help pay teachers, went out at great personal risk to do that, and was a great chamber chair, and then did what all chamber chairs do in the next succeeding year. You go into withdrawal. You've gone from being intimately involved with everything, knowing how everything works, who everybody is, to going back, and I think you brought self-service poodle wash to the store or something. He reinvented his business. So cruising through all that time, while he was chamber chair, we were involved with the school board, and we had an arch nemesis. His name was David Thibodeau. May he rest in peace. But David was a challenge, and he was the challenge. And the question was, what are we going to do? There was an election coming up in 2002, and actually, as fate would have it, David Thibodeau is responsible for Joey being here tonight and having served the last 12 years. Because we sat down and we pulled out the old Scoutmaster recruiting handbook, and the first thing it tells you is, don't figure out who might do it, figure out who the best person would be. Who's the best possible person? And we had the search committee, Greg Davis and Jeannie Kramer and Mike Skinner and myself. And we thought about it and we said, well, you know, we got the guy, Joey. We can cut the head off the snake. Let's get Joey. He's in that district. It'll be great. So we had a meeting and we invited Joey and Lynn because one of the things it tells you in the Scoutmaster Recruitment Handbook is you invite the guy or whoever the candidate is and their spouse because you got to sell them both. So we met at the office and sat down, and it was good news. We've got the right person. And they said, great, who is it? And we said, Joey. And they both said, we've got to think about that a little bit. So they went home and they thought about it. We didn't realize that Lynn's grandfather had been sheriff of St. Landry Parish. Politics runs deep in her blood. She was willing to make the challenge and make the race. Joey's in retail. It was perfect. They came back, said, we're in. We'll do it. It'll make a difference. Get ready for the campaign. We're all ready. And then we realized, oops, they moved the district line from the Vermilion River to East Bayou Parkway. Well, Joey's home and Lynn's home is on the Vermilion River. He's in Judy Cox's district, not in David Thibodeau's district. We're not gaining any ground there. Judy was doing just fine. And so it was kind of like, darn. Well, the thought goes on. And the nice thing at that time, we've consolidated the elections now, but the following year was the consolidated government elections. So the thought started forming, well, we had a good man and a good woman backing him up. What about city parish president? He's the guy. What a difference that would make. How that would transform Lafayette. And so several, Clay, Bill, several other folks got together and talked with them, and they decided to do it. And not just them, but the whole family. I mean, they were walking machines. So the campaign started. Of course, he won, and we're delighted with that. But backing up a little bit, let's talk about Don Bakke and where he fits in. That wasn't a casual encounter that Joey had with Don. Now, the important thing about tonight is remember, the facts don't matter as long as the stories are true, okay? So, this is one of those. we got together, Joey's ready to make the run, and it's, well, you know, it's going to be a pretty formidable race. We need a campaign chairman. We need somebody with some gravitas. Who could that be? Well, Don had been in the legislature, Vietnam veteran, well-respected in the community, chamber chair. I mean, just who else would you rather have than Don Bache being your campaign chair? So Joey, being the good retailer that he is, figured out how to ask Don. And I didn't know that story until actually we were preparing for this. And he made the sale. So we're in the campaign, and you know, you got to do all the stuff. And the first big event we had was a fundraiser out at the airport in a hangar for a crawfish boil. It was great. There were bunches of people everywhere. We had plenty of place to park. It was a nice night. Joey's walking up, and he's got his notes in front of him here, and his speech is all typed out. And we had talked about the fact that, you know, you don't give a speech from notes. You got to connect with people. You got to look at them. You got to talk to them. You got to be with them. So he's walking up, and he's kind of looking at this, and he said something to the effect of, "You weren't serious about memorizing that speech, were you?" And I said, "Well, yeah." So he turned around and went in the parking lot and started trying to memorize the speech. And he came in, we got started. He's up on the stand, everybody's there. This is his rolling out party. And he's introducing his family, because that's what you're supposed to do. And he's got a wonderful family, and they were tremendously supportive. And I remember at one point he introduced his daughter, Nicole. And then he introduced his daughter, Jason. And he caught himself and looked at everybody and said, and pointed to Jason and said, "He's nervous." That's when we knew we had a keeper. It was really encouraging at that point. So you're going to hear a lot about what he's done since he's been in office. What you need to know is, you know, we had this really fine lump of clay, but it was really going to take a lot of work. But the lump of clay was willing to put the time in and do the work. And so after the debut out at the airport, it was a matter of, okay, we got to get together and we got to do this right. We're going to have to rehearse. We're going to have to make sure that the announcement that Joey was going to do hit all the marks and was smooth and was something that people could relate to. I want to show you how we got there. Jim? Can you roll it?
Good afternoon. Thank you for having me. Well, thank you for being here. We are at an exciting time and place in Lafayette Parish. We have the resources, the location, and a university that has shown that it has a leadership, it is a leader in academics and research. And those days will be gone. I bring to that table an experience that comes from meeting challenges and turning them into opportunities. I believe I have the ability, energy, and enthusiasm. This race is also about vision. Who has it and who has the ability to lead Lafayette into the future? Take a good look at me, at my background. I come from the business world, primarily retailing. Retailing is a customer service business. And government is the ultimate customer service business. Consolidated government is made up of 15 departments. Think of it as 15 small businesses. Think of it as 15 specialty businesses. The first job of the city parish president is to find and to hire the best 15 managers to run those specialty businesses. They've got to be the most honest, the most qualified, honest, and professional women and men that we can find. Where we are, who we are, is the people looking forward to a better, brighter future that will combine our strong heritage and community values with a determination to build a future for all who call Lafayette Parish and Acadiana home. I will take, if you let me, the next city parish president. as I've done in my personal life, as I've done in my private life, as I've done my entire life with business and civic organizations, I will work with every segment of this community to make certain that consolidation is working the way it's supposed to. Finally, we have to raise the bar in government. It is time for vision and leadership to take us into the future, rather than having us sentenced to maintaining the status quo. I believe in the people of Lafayette Parish, and I know you can believe in me. God bless America, and God bless Indiana. I'll do it. How you do tonight? I believe in the people of Lafayette Parish, and I know you can believe in me. God bless America. God bless Acadiana. Perfect. We can all go home.
It's been remarkable. Now, when you get into the ground floor with somebody like Joy, you know, there are some perks that come with it. And I've benefited from a couple of those perks. One of them was Mardi Gras. I got to be driving Mr. Joey. And I got to do that for 4 years. And it's not because Joey trusted me or it was an honored position. I owned the convertible. And I would pick Joey up and we would stack it with the beads because that's how much it took. And we'd go to breakfast with the crews, and we did our rounds, and then we'd suffer through it, and it was just great. We learned that there's a lot of dental work that needs to be done in Lafayette, because when you're at that level, instead of on a float, you get to see people yelling at you. It was pretty impressive. And all 250,000 of them voted for Joey. Except her. So, I have this. This is one of my memory beads from that trip, that and the next photo, which is the Marquis de Lafayette for the birthday. That was the special occasion, and we both enjoyed that. Right, Joey? The other thing that I got was Festival International. The mayor president had festival passes. You could, with this, get to two of the side stages and have one meal a day. And my family thought I was the Bob. It was great. So with that, let me just say one thing before I present these to Joy, and I'll walk over there and deliver them to you. Joy's a good scout. He's leaving Lafayette better than he found it. That's what makes him special. Thank you, Joy.
After seeing that video, can you imagine that all four of us stayed in the race? Knowing that it was probably impossible, but we were committed. But someone else, I mentioned Ben Berthelot. Ben Berthelot, as I spoke of him earlier, was the first first paid volunteer, and Ben has some wonderful memories of not only the campaign, but what happened after Joey unexpectedly got elected.
Thank you, Don. Well, other than Pat Ottinger, I don't have any friends as old as Joey, so this is the first time I've been involved with a roast like this, and none of my younger friends have done anything worthwhile of being roasted for. In case you were wondering, in the videos Gary just showed, I was the one in the back of the room saying to myself, did I just leave a good job at Coca-Cola to run Elmer Fudd's campaign? And I did. And it was worth it. For 6 months during the campaign, I was with Joey and his family every day. Our consultant said I was to run the campaign office, be his driver, his bodyguard, believe it or not, and the person who walked him through the crowds. Of course, stubborn like Joey was, it took him 2 months to let me drive his car. And we never quite got the walking gracefully through the crowd part down. But we laughed a lot. On inauguration day, I was sitting in my big office admiring my desk and hanging pictures on the wall. And Joey walked in and he said, "Ben, do you know what you're going to be doing?" And I said, "No, I don't." And he said, "Don't worry, neither do I." And I don't think either of us knew what we were going to be doing at that point. But the phone started ringing and the emails started coming in. And we had a radio show to prepare for. Of all the things we did early in his tenure, the radio show was probably my most favorite thing to accompany him to. When a caller would say something kind about him, he was quick with his one-liner. "I want to thank my brother for calling in just now." And when things didn't go so well, it was, "Get to the point," or, "So what's your point?" Or, my personal favorite, "Grow up." And a lot of callers were made to realize they needed to grow up over the years in Lafayette during Joey's radio show. We're much better off for that. When those tough shows were over, I generally walk out of the room with them and say something like, "That went well." "Good show." Or, "Great job." Knowing that the second he got into his car, Miss Lennon was on the phone letting him have it, and the second we walked back into the office, Becky Perrette and Dee were going to let him have it as well. It never failed. Given Joey's message to the media, you might have heard about that heads were going to roll if the TND ordinance wasn't passed, you probably think Joey ran a tight ship. And he did, especially when he was out of town. I have a couple of photos to show of that, Jim, if you wouldn't mind. His number two assistant, Bobby Cormier, working hard while Joey was out of the office. And it's, when Joey was out of the office, the fish are always biting in the aquarium in his office, and we caught some big ones back in the day. So he certainly ran a tight ship. And with Bobby and I back home to keep City Hall running, he was free to travel the world and be the number one salesperson for Lafayette Parish. Travels to our sister cities allowed him to develop a love and passion for the French language. When he started, the only word in his vocabulary was bonjour. Now, 12 years later, being the quick study he is, his French vocabulary has tripled, having added au revoir and merci to his repertoire. And Philippe is so proud. And now, it's our turn to say au revoir and merci, Joey. You've been a great friend to me personally, a great boss, a great mentor, and a great leader for our area. We're going to miss you a lot, and I just want to thank you for everything. Thank you so much.
And Joey, now you know when the cat's away, the mice will play. Next, we're going to hear from Robert Daigle. One of the things that Joey always said was, "My administration will be without stain. I will never embarrass you." And in public, he never has. But some things have happened that none of us know about, and Robert's going to talk about them.
Thanks, Don. You're probably most worried about what I have to say, and there's cause for the concern, Joey. You know, oftentimes when you're asked to roast someone, it's someone who has had a stellar career, who has not made many missteps in life, who has not publicly said anything stupid or publicly acted in a stupid fashion. In those cases, it's very difficult to come up with enough ammunition. We don't have that issue today or tonight. Joey and I go way back to our days at Our Lady of Fatima. He was a couple of years behind me, and we really didn't have any interaction at all. And I really didn't get to know Joey at all until we started our River Ranch project. And I'll never forget the first serious conversation I had with Joey. We were in our little temporary office at the front of River Ranch, first 6 months of our development. And Joey stops by and says, you know, you got a minute to visit with me? And I said, sure, Joey. So he sits down and he says, you know, man, I want to get your reaction to something. I've got a big decision I need to make, and I'd like your thoughts on it. And I said, well, sure, Joey, what is it? He said, I want to run for parish president. And so I took a big gulp and didn't know how to respond right away. And I said, well, you know, tell me about your aspirations. What do you want to accomplish? And so he gave me 5 minutes of dialogue about what he intended to do and why he was running. And so he's getting ready to leave, and he gives me this handout. And he said, you know, would you leave a stack of these at the front of the office and pass them out to people that come into the River Ranch office? And I said, sure. So I pick up the stack, I pull one off the top, and, you know, he's got this little card that summarizes his qualifications for the office that he intended to run for. And it starts with his success as a small business owner, proceeds to talk about his chairmanship of the Chamber of Commerce, and pretty impressive stuff. And we get down to the section at the bottom of the card on his academic achievements. And the top of the list, he's got member of Kappa Sigma fraternity. So I looked at him and I said, Joey, I may be mistaken, but I don't think Kappa Sigma is an academic organization. And so he gives me this deer in the headlights look, and he says, really? I said, yeah, really, Joey. Well, fast forward, he runs for office, he gets elected, much to the surprise of many people in the community, and he is in office. He's the leader of our free world as we know it. And of course, as he progressed through his three terms, the reputation that he's established, the perception that we all have of Joey is that he is this honest, forthright, great guy, never touched or hinted at anything unethical, Mr. Boy Scout / choir boy. That's the perception. The reality is something entirely different, and we're gonna talk about the reality of that now. If you remember, several years ago, our local media picked up on a story that Joey and I, me on behalf of our River Ranch group, and Joey on behalf of Joey, had engaged in a number of real estate transactions. And of course, the hint in these media stories was that there was something underhanded and unethical about these dealings. And first of all, I want to clear one thing up, Steve and Cherry and Leslie, wherever she is. The Independent did not play any role in these articles about Joey and I's relationship. To no surprise at all, because we all know that the Independent would never stoop to such sordid journalism designed to embarrass a public businessman in Lafayette Parish. So, I digressed a little bit. I forgot who I was roasting here. Okay. Back to my friend Joey. So these articles come out, and you know I kind of shrugged them off, and Joey kind of shrugged them off. But the history behind these transactions is what I want to talk about today. At the start of this business relationship that we had. Joey shows up at my office one day and he says, you know, Robert, I want to sell my house. His house is immediately adjacent to River Ranch. Do we have the first slide? Okay. That's an actual aerial of his residence there. As you can see, his property abuts River Ranch. And so he comes in and he says, I want to sell my house. I said, wow, that's good, Joey. And he said, I think you and Rodney are the logical buyers. And so I said, well, you know, Joey, that might make sense. You know, let's talk about it. And I said, do you have any idea what you want for the house? And he says, yeah, I want $3.5 million. I said, $3.5 million? He said, yeah, I want $3.5 million. I said, you know, Joey, that's a little rich for our blood. I said, even at the prices we get in River Ranch, which are ridiculously high prices, I said, $3.5 million is even expensive by our standards. And I said, you know, no. He said, well, what do you think it's worth? I said, $2 million tops. He said, no, I want $3.5 million. And I said, well, look, I'm sorry, we can't make a deal. So he gets up, and I can tell he's a little chagrined about the nature of the conversation. So fast forward a few months, we have a new phase of our development that we've submitted to the city of Lafayette. And as in all of our phases, we have to get 20, 30, 40 variances to develop the way that we develop. So I'm 2 or 3 days before the big planning commission hearing to go get my variances, and Joey shows up at my office. He said, you know, can we talk a little bit? So I said, sure. He said, got another proposition for you. I said, okay, Joey, let's hear it. Next. So he said, instead of you buying my house, he said, I've got this excess real estate. He said, if you look at the boundary of the River Ranch property, there's a little jog in it, and I'm going to help you straighten that boundary out by selling you this little strip of land that's shown in red. And I said, oh, okay. And he says, and oh, by the way, I mean, how are you feeling about the upcoming Planning and Zoning Commission hearing? And I said, I was feeling pretty good, Joey, until you got here. But I said, I feel pretty good about it. He said, but anyway, he said, don't you think that acquisition makes sense to you guys? And I said, well, actually it does, Joey. I said, you know, what do you want for it? And he said, well, you know, I want $15 a square foot for it. And I said, well, Joey, you know, we're not even getting $15 a square foot in River Ranch. And he said, no, look, you know, if you get those zoning issues resolved, value of your land is going to keep going up. I said, yeah, you're right. So anyway, make a long story short, we agreed to pay him this $15 a square foot. It wasn't that much real estate, and it wasn't that big a deal. And so I said, Joey, you want your lawyer to close this deal, or you want my lawyer to close the deal? And he said, no, I want you to close the deal. I said, me personally? He said, yeah, you're a lawyer. He said, you can prepare a sale. I said, yeah, I can prepare a sale. He said, I want you to do it. I want to do it in your office. And I want the sale to reflect just a couple of dollars in consideration. And I want to be paid in cash. I said, cash? He said, you mean you want a cash sale that we? He said, no. He said, I want cash, real cash. I said, okay. So we closed the deal. Fast forward, next slide. I can't make this up, okay? Joey shows up 6 months later, literally 2 or 3 days before my next planning and zoning hearing, and says, you know, Robert, don't you want some more river frontage? Joey, I'd love some more river frontage. He said, well, look, I got some. I want to sell you this little triangular piece of land, And he said, I think it'd be a good addition to your real estate. So, well, what do you want for it? He said, well, I want $20 a square foot. I said, $20 a square foot. I said, okay. I said, actually, that works for us, Joey. And so we consummated the deal the same way we consummated the first deal, in my office, cash sale, cash, exchange hands. Fast forward another 6 months. So I'm not going to bore you with the details because this gets a little repetitive, but we had a third transaction, just as you see here. Fast forward again. We had a fourth transaction, just as you see here. Fast forward again. We have a fifth transaction. So by this time, I'm going to Rodney every time we've got to discuss buying this property. And so, you know, Rodney says, what do you think he's doing with the cash? And so I said, you know, I don't know. I mean, every time I pick up the paper, he's in Canada, he's in Paris. So I said, I don't know, but I'm going to ask him. I said, this is kind of crazy. So we close this sale number five, and we're preparing for sale number six. And finally, I just couldn't help myself. I said, Joey, I mean, what are you doing with the money? I mean, I'm reading, you know, you're traveling here, you're traveling there. I said, you know, is that what you're spending the cash on? He said, spending my cash on traveling? He said, Robert, he said, I've got 100,000 suckers, I mean voters, that are paying for all of these government-sponsored trips. He said, no, not at all. So Rodney and I are looking at sale number six, and Rodney says, you know, if this thing goes through, he's just about obliterated the view from his house down to the river. And I said, you know, Rodney, I don't know what to tell you. I mean, he wants us to buy some extra land. And so Rodney said, man, this guy's a real dumbass. And I said, you know, no one's ever accused him of being the sharpest knife in the drawer. But I said, it is what it is. And I think we need to do the deal. We've got another planning and zoning hearing coming up. And I said, we just got to do it. So lo and behold, another 6 months, our next hearing comes along, and we've got sale number seven that takes place. And of course, every time these sales are taking place, the price goes up $5 a square foot. Same transactions, cash sales, cash exchange. And then finally, Joey comes to us one last time, and he says, I've got one other piece of property I want to sell you. So we look at sale number eight, and this was just too much, because sale number eight, as you can see, eliminates all of his rear yard. There's no place to step outside of on these back porch. You're stepping onto my property at that point in time. And so I said, Joey, I said, I got to tell you, I mean, this is too much. What does Lynn think about this? And he said, well, Lynn's fine with it. I said, Lynn is fine with you selling your entire backyard. And he says, listen, I've been upfront with Lynn from the start of this thing. I said, really? He said, absolutely. I have been upfront with her. I've told her every step of the way exactly how this is going to come down. I said, really? He said, yeah. When I decided to sell the house, I went to Lynn and said, Lynn, you know, we're going to sell the house. She was fine with that. I said, okay. He said, the other thing I promised her is that wherever we would end up, we would end up at a place that had a lot less maintenance associated with it. And he says, as you can see, I just got rid of 4 acres of maintenance. So he said, surely she's going to be happy with that. I said, really? He said, yeah. And he said, the other thing I told her was that wherever we moved or wherever we lived, she would always have a riverfront home site. Next one. And he said, if you notice all the property I bought from you, I reserved a 2-foot strip. And he said, so Lynn's got her riverfront home site. I said, really? He said, yeah. And he said, the last thing I told her was that, Lynn, at the end of the day, these dumbasses from River Ranch are going to pay us $3.5 million for this house. And that's exactly what happened. So in that last transaction, we're getting ready to walk out after he makes that comment to me. And he says, you know, Robert, he said, I've enjoyed doing business with you. And I said, well, Joey, that makes one of us, okay? But so he said, I said, but, you know, help me out of here. All this cash you got, all this cash that we paid you. I said, you're not concerned about, you know, anybody finding out about it or whatever? I said, did you pay taxes on it? He said, pay taxes? He said, duh. Why do you think I want cash? He said, I'm not about to pay money to the federal government and have them waste it. He said, I know what that's about. I've been wasting federal taxpayer dollars now for 12 years. I said, so you're not concerned about that? He said, no, I'm not. He said, believe me, I have covered my tracks. And I said, well, that's a great thing. So he's walking out of my office, and he turns to me with this little smile on his face. He said, I guess I got the last laugh. And tonight, Joey, I want to tell you that you got the second to last laugh. Okay? Clay Allen helped me install that video system in my office. So, Joey, I want to leave you with one thought, okay? That photo is one click away from the IRS, okay? However, I do think there's a resolution that's fair to all concerned. I've got a little piece of land that you're going to pay me $3.5 million for, okay? On a serious note, and he didn't do most of what I described, but he did do some of it. But on a serious note, when people ask me all the time, you know, what do you attribute the success of River Ranch to and some of our other projects? You know, my response always is, I'm the beneficiary of a great business partner, best business partner you could have in Rodney. I'm the beneficiary of a great life partner in my wife, Leanne. And I'm the beneficiary of relationships that I've built with great, well-intentioned people. When we announced our River Ranch project, all hell broke loose and surrounding neighborhoods thought we were going to ruin their property values and bring Walmart up to their back doors. And Joey, long before he decided to run for office, was a resident of Steiner Road and was in some of those neighborhood meetings that we were having, where I was trying to convince the neighbors that we were going to do something positive. And of course, no one wanted to believe that we would do what was in our master plan. And Joey stood up in those meetings. And believe me, he was the only one that stood up in those meetings to say anything positive. But he looked at his neighbors and he said, you know, these guys are telling us they're going to do something wonderful. And, you know, how can you be so skeptical? And that says everything about Joey. Joey views life differently than a lot of other people. Joey dreams of things and tries to achieve them. And Joey, I think, also appreciates the other dreamers of the world. And certainly in retrospect, we were dreaming about maybe what could happen with this project. But he put his personal relationships with his neighbors on the line when he stood up and supported us as a resident, not as the mayor. When he got into office, his door was always open. And I can't count the number of discussions and meetings I had with him about what we needed to make this project work, not in terms of dollars or any help from the city financially, because we never asked for any of that, but just from the standpoint of paying attention to what our needs were and determining whether we were doing something positive for the city, and if so, stepping forward and having dialogue about how to make it work instead of listing all the reasons why it couldn't work. And for that, I'm truly appreciative. I'm appreciative of our relationship, Joey. You're a great guy. You've done a phenomenal job, and you're one of those handful of individuals in my life that has made me a better person just knowing you. So thanks a million. Appreciate your friendship and everything you do for us.
And we thought Joey was simple. I don't know if Jim Kraft leaving has anything to do with that photograph. We can always speculate. The next roasters are Judy Terzadas and Flaxenhauer with Daily Advertiser. Sometimes even the MCs make mistakes.
Hi, good evening.
That was on purpose.
Joey set that up.
Are you okay?
I'll try not to fall off the stage, too.
This concludes our presentation. Thank you. So it should be clear by now that Mayor Durel has dominated headlines locally, but we in the sordid media, we wondered whether he dominates the news at home, but how does he stack up against the world? So we put together this presentation year by year through the Durel administration just to answer this question that everybody should want the answer to. In 2003, Joey Durel was elected mayor, but at the same time, Elvis was seen at Graceland. Who wins in this headline challenge, Judy?
Huh, I guess, Joey, you win this headline challenge. So, the score, Durel 1-0 for World News.
In 2004, Mayor Durel actually takes office, but at the same time, a headless body is found in a topless bar.
Gosh, I'm sorry, Joey, the body has to win. 1-1 is the score.
The body has been winning in this competition since 1984, I'm sorry. In 2005, Durel gave a speech, Fiber Begins at Home. And that went up against Elton Takes David Up the Aisle. Stiff competition. Who won here?
The fiber won, dummy. And the score now, 2-1.
We move on to 2006, where Mayor Durel proposed a drainage tax. I know you all remember that. But at the same time, Elliot Spitzer is snared in a pay-for-love-gov. The winner here is?
The drainage had to win.
Exactly.
Okay, so we got a score now of 3-1. Pulling ahead.
Those are probably similar stories when you think about it. In 2007, Durel sells fiber bonds out of his own trunk. That's probably a misdemeanor, but we roll differently in Lafayette. But at the same time, Leonard Nimoy dies. Don't forget, this is fiber we're talking about here. Who won?
All right, still the fiber. Okay, so score now 4-1.
In 2008, Durel observes School Counselor Week. That was memorable as well. At the same time, Osama is captured by rednecks.
The rednecks has got to get it, right?
Exactly.
All right, the score 4-2.
In 2009, Durel readies the swine flu defense against an epidemic that never came, but we were ready. At the same time,
Yeah, I don't know what that is.
All right.
So I guess we'll let Joey win that one.
Yeah, right? Joey, winner. In 2010, the Mayor Durel seeks pet mall for horse farm, an early plan you might not have heard about, but yet it was proposed. And Dick Cheney is discovered to be a robot.
Yeah, the pets have got to win.
Yep. Pets and fiber are at the top.
All right,
top
is it
of the
even
list.
Close? What's the score? 5-2.
That's a commanding lead.
It is.
Let's move on to 2011 when the Durel Doctrine was announced. I'll meet anyone, anywhere, and I took this literally from joeydurel.com. So it is true. I don't know what it means, but it's true. At the same time, a 500-point-plus drop in the Dow, he's the only guy cleaning up on Wall Street. This has credentials.
Yeah, the bull has to win on that one.
And
bigger story,
is?
I think. And 5-3.
Okay, 2012, mayor releases bicentennial calendar. These are major headlines that rocked Lafayette. At the same time in the world, oh no, who put Obama in there? The only other thing would be like Hillary, but okay, Obama wins. Who wins here?
Yeah, the calendar beats Obama.
A calendar would beat Obama anytime. Absolutely.
So 6-3.
6-3. In 2013, Durel praises master gardeners. Any master gardeners here tonight? Very good. You're more than welcome. Elsewhere in the world, oh, come on. All right, Hillary Clinton. Who wins here?
Oh, the gardens win.
Absolutely, yeah. Right. We only have two more years left. And the score is?
7-3.
In 2014, Durel calls the RV ordinance vague. Tough language. At the same time, girl eats 4,000 washing up sponges.
Yeah, I got to go with the sponges.
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. We know what real news is.
We do.
I think the mayor may win here.
I think he might.
But in 2015, Durel becomes Uber's rider zero. And that goes up against, hey, wait a minute.
Wait a second.
That's not fair. That's Durel as well.
He's going to win no matter
what.
He's
got the whole thing cooked.
He does.
Okay, and the winner is?
Oh, he still wins. 8-4.
Congratulations, Mayor. But it's, you know, a career is not defined by headlines alone, and there is more to Joey than meets the eye. And we dug deep into our files of Gannett and the Daily Advertiser, and we have the top 10 things you never knew about Mayor Joey Durel. Who starts with this? This is you?
I did. Very good.
Okay. We rehearsed this.
Number 10. Yeah, I got to be able to read. He's been called ahead of his time, although 3 minutes is no big deal.
Exactly. Number 9, the high-speed internet was born when Joey misunderstood his doctor's advice to get more fiber into his life.
Number 8, he's so extroverted, he can speak at the opening of a door.
Gotta like that. Number 7, he once had hair, but then he met Lou Benjamin and Chris Williams.
Number 6, in 12 years as mayor, he's seen it all, but understood very little of it.
Number 5, he once called the mosquito control program his new pet store.
Number 4, you can talk for hours about Mayor Durrell's accomplishments, but only if you can read his handwriting.
I know, that's true. Number 3, he uses Project Front Yard as a pickup line.
Number 2, with the CNG buses run out of fuel, his speeches are read into the gas tank.
You have to think about that. And the number 1 thing you don't know about Mayor Joey Durel, he wanted to name both his son and daughter Greg Gothro, but Lynn said no.
So Joey, I just personally want to thank you so much. I've been in Lafayette for 2.5 years, and you were one of the first people that I felt really welcomed me to the community, helped me plug in, and just really have been a great friend to the Daily Advertiser for years and years before I entered the market. But thank you for all your support. I was telling Greg Gothro today that I've texted Joey at 2:00 on a Sunday afternoon, and he texts me right back. I mean, you don't find that in many communities. You don't find a mayor that really cares and is responsive, and it's a blessing for our community. You will really be missed. We appreciate you.
I hope all of you all noted the cat-like grace that I used in recovering from that fall. We've heard a lot about fiber, but we haven't heard from the person who's in charge of fiber. So if Terry Huval will come up now and bring your box of cereal with you.
Thanks a bunch. After Daigle got up here, I thought this thing was shut down before we got finished with this. No, I've got a couple of things I wanted to comment on. One is that I entered this job in 1994 working for Kenny Bowen. That was an interesting life. And then I worked for Walter Como, which was another interesting life. Both guys very politically astute, and I knew that whenever I appeared in a campaign commercial for Glenn Weber and put $1,000 in his campaign and it hit the front page of the paper and Glenn lost, I thought, oh, shucks, or something like that. And then this guy, Joey Durel, who I'd known fairly well through the Chamber of Commerce when I was on the board, comes in my office several days after the election and wants to visit with me and offers me a job. And I'm thinking, neither Cannon nor Walter would have ever done that. And I realized this guy has to be different. And when I said, well, let me go through a mea culpa with you to tell you that, you know, I'm sorry I kind of messed up and getting involved in the last campaign, he said, Terry, says, I mean, you work for those people. I expect you're going to be loyal to them if you work for them. He said, that's the kind of person I want to have working for me. I thought, man, this guy is so different than any other politician I've ever met. And so I felt so good about it. I said, hey, look, I got this fiber project idea I'd like to throw by you. What do you think about it? And he said, you know, I don't know if we should do this or not, but shame on us if we don't at least look at it. And that was a Joey Durel that I kind of really just kind of fell in love with for the last 12 years, because he was always willing to look at things. He was always willing to consider things. And he always gave you a candid perspective as to how he saw things. But I always thought Joey sometimes was a little naive on some things. Like, you know, not long after he came into office, he got on this KPL show that Ben was talking about. And then he agrees with the independent to have this State of the Union message thing. And then he's appearing on television. I'm thinking, man, the press is going to eat him up doing that stuff. And I remember the guy that called one time, and he was complaining about traffic and how the folks at Richard Ranch had all the speed bumps and so forth, but he couldn't get in front of his house. And before the guy could finish, Joey says, grow up. And the guy says, what? And he says, grow up. And you could hear the guy's wife in the background say, what did he say, honey? He said, don't grow up. And, you know, as long as Joey was on that program for a long time, I caught it every Thursday morning because I knew that I was going to have to fix up something that he said on there that wasn't completely right. You know, and after all, we got kind of used to it and kind of got past all of that. And on Joey speaking French, there he did pick up another term, oui, oui. But I never was sure if he meant oui, oui or oui, oui. Now, y'all had a chance to see Joey in action when he was getting ready to run for city parish president. But you know, we have done some commercials with Joey, and I guess I'd like, Jim, if you don't mind, maybe could you run that first commercial of Joey? This is just in recent times to show the improvement he's made since that time.
Hi, I'm Joey Durel. 12 years ago, we made a promise to the people of Lafayette to build the infrastructure of the future while also providing you an alternative.
Okay, take two.
Hi, I'm Joey Durel.
Does that help?
It's a nice picture, huh? From way back when. Then, Joey was always in for doing things that were, I guess, not typically mayoral. You know, just kind of doing kind of crazy things. And we have a picture of a foursome of recent times that you might recognize. Can you put that up there for me, Jim? There we go. For those that don't recognize everyone in that picture, to the left is Ben Berthelot. And next to him is Dee Stanley, the guy with the tall hair, and the guy with the tongue on the right-hand side is Joey. Kind of scared. Well, go to the next slide, if you don't mind. That's kind of causing me pain. So, in the end, I want to just comment about, it's been a blast working for you, Joey. We've had such fun times. We've laughed as much as we strained on things, and certainly that whole fiber project, going from the concept that we had and taking it through all these strange, difficult challenges we had to go through. There is nobody in the world that's had to go through what we had to go through in this fiber project. And I'm not saying because I'm here doing it, I'm just telling you, we had thing after thing after thing after thing. I kept getting in our way. And every now and then I would think, well, Joey's going to give up on this. You know, we lost another lawsuit or we whatever. He said, okay, what do we do next? What's the next step we're going to take? It just never, ever gave up. And it's because of him that it happened. I always said that when you get in a job like mine, what the mayor says means everything. Because that first conversation I had with him about the fiber project, all he would have had to say is one word, it would never happen, and that answer was no. He didn't. And not only did he not say no then, but he didn't say no when people said, you know what, it's kind of risky politically, and you maybe shouldn't do it. He said no. He said, I'm going to do what's the right thing to get done. I'm going to keep moving what's good for the community. So, Joey, it's been great working for you, best boss I've ever had, and I wish you the best in your retirement. Thank you.
Thank you, Terry. Next, we're going to have T.Joe Savoy, who collaborated with Joey on the horse farm, and maybe that's where some of that $3.5 million in cash went.
Well, good evening. It's really a pleasure to be here on this fine occasion to have a little fun with my friend Joey Durel. It's good for all of us after this very difficult election campaign that we just went through, very difficult state elections and local elections. And as a friend, Joey, I'm going to ask you, please don't ever endorse me for anything. Now, Joey and I have known each other for a long time. In fact, we share a lot in common. Most of that, though, is not by my choice. Joey is kind of like a feral cat. You feed him, you can't ever get rid of him. He's really a copycat, and you'll see lots of traits of monkey see, monkey do. Now, Joey and I go back a long time. We were fraternity brothers. I joined Kappa Sigma Fraternity, which was referred to earlier. Sure enough, Joey joins Kappa Sig. And from there, I could never shake him. He continued to mimic me. Sometimes he would immediately imitate me, and sometimes his plot and his unoriginal ideas took years to come to fruition. One time in the fraternity, I organized a leading of the cavalry on horseback for homecoming. Well, that must have made an impression on Joey, because it seems that he tried to lead every parade and any event that he participated in by horse. Where's that? There we go. Now, I was working in the government sector, and Joey, despite his shortcomings, decided that he needed to be in government as well. The pattern of monkey see and monkey do continued. He copied my fashion sense. We had a horse farm at UL, and Joey decided he needed one. Yeah. In fact, he needed ours. So we sold it to him at much more than it was worth. You can see who's smiling with his check. We added bike lanes to campus. So Joey decided the city needed bike lanes too. This is riding in the library, by the way. It was raining outside. The university launched a master plan to improve campus. And then Joey had to launch a comprehensive plan for Lafayette City government. Heck, he even used the same architect, Steve Uve of Architect Southwest. And we both paid much more than it was worth. Now, our students started the big event with United Way in 2013, 3,000 students going out and cleaning up and sprucing up our community. A year later, Joey had the bright idea to launch Project Front Yard. We passed a referendum to fund the campus master plan. Then Joey worked to get the airport funding passed. Finally, he got an improvement proposal passed. It was an amazing thing, Joey. Now we want you to know that Joey is currently looking for work. So with his love of animals and all of his monkey see, monkey do, I'm here today to tell you that I've offered him a job at the New Iberia Primate Research Center. I think he'll fit in just fine. Monkey see, monkey do. Now, the truth is that Joey's accomplished much in his tenure and made our community better. You can take it off. I'm trying to get serious right now. His ability. America's still a wonderful country, isn't it? People can rise anywhere beyond expectation. Joey has done a whole lot for our community. I think one of the best things that he's done is really embraced the university and working together with us. When I was meeting with leaders from CGI and Proficient and Quero and other companies that were looking to locate here, they all told me how impressed they were with the strength of the relationships between the university and city parish government, as well as the business community. So Joey's been a big part of that success. Joey's been a positive influence on Lafayette. I'm proud of you, and I'm proud to count you as a friend. So tonight, I'm going to steal a line, monkey see, monkey do, from our football coach, Mark Hudspeth, and I think we've got something here, and to say, Joey, thank you for holding on to the rope. You never let it go. You were always determined to move Lafayette forward. So we want to present you with a piece of the original rope that went to four New Orleans Bowl championships, and I want to thank you for your great service and friendship.
We're still waiting on D. Stanley. The council meeting must have run over, and we do have a live shot. AOC is here tonight, so we're going to break away to see what's going on as far as the council is concerned right now, if that's okay. Is that a yes or no? Can't do it? Ready? We have a few technical. Oh, here we go.
To the president for the executive president's report. Mr. Durant. Oh, well, he's not here. Mr. Stanley, can you handle that for us?
Surprise. I would have hoped that on the last council meeting of the term that the city parish president would have been here. I guess in order to have a president's report, I need to have a president, right? But he's, hang on 1 second. We don't, you know,
really?
since he's not here, we might as well just have him officially not be here. I have nothing as usual, Mr. President.
Yeah, you know, that's funny. Even when the president is here, y'all have nothing. matter of fact, Assistant Chair, Vice Chair Castillo, there's some things that we need to take care of in this final meeting, and in the absence of the president, I mean, he's been absent for the last 12 years, but on this day, his final day, I know there was a move to raise the speed limit on Camellia Boulevard, especially the River Ranch side, where the speed limit should be 65 miles per hour.
Absolutely. I think we should let Tony, I know he's in retirement, but we should bring Mr. Trammell back to have conversations about that.
Okay, we'll get Tony back. Anything else?
Definitely the horse farm issue, the maintenance funds and everything to do with that horse farm. We need to stop all that funding so we can see exactly what's going on there, because we to this day still don't know what's going on there.
Yeah, probably so horsing around at the horse farm as we speak.
I'm sure him and Greg are having fun.
Is there some specifics to the motion as it relates to this administration? Because when it comes to that, Mr. Castile has been short on specifics for about 8 years.
Oh, yeah, that's true. I got to give him that.
Unless it relates to fireman's pay. Then he's gold, right?
Well, yeah. Mr. Durrell's lucky because I cut his cell phone use out, but he's got one meeting left.
So he's okay with that. Objection.
That'll actually do us very little good, but he never calls us anyway. He just does what he always wants to do.
But I bet you if I text him, he'll answer a text.
Yeah.
He does that a lot.
Yeah. Yeah.
But so what's the motion? A point of clarity, Mr. Chairman, a point of clarity. What's the motion?
The motion is that we're going to raise the speed limit on Camellia Boulevard. We're going to cut funding to the horse farm. We're going to revisit the comprehensive plan because there's actually nothing comprehensive about it. It's all about South Lafayette. And finally, last but not least, way too many assistants to the presidents. I mean, I've seen at least 8 come through this office in the last 8 years, so we need to do something about that.
I guess he should have been here for the president's report.
That would have helped.
That would have helped out a lot, yes.
Y'all going to vote on this thing?
Absolutely. That's my motion, Mr. Chair.
That's your motion. Do I have a second? Second by Mr. Terrio. Thank you very much. There is something Mr. Terrio says yes to.
It is Christmas time.
Stoops, I mean, am I missing something?
Mr. Stanley, I think you spoke a little bit too much. That kills your mic. Thank you very much. Madam Clerk, would you please call the vote?
District 1?
Yes.
District 2?
Yes.
District 3?
Yes.
District 4?
Yes.
District 5?
No.
District 6?
No.
District 7?
Yes.
District 8?
Yes.
District 9?
No.
That I certainly want to say after 12 years in this chair is that it has been an amazing ride. Over 4,300 days, have worked with you gentlemen for the last 8 years, have known you a lot longer, and I think there's just no question that this administration and the job that's been done under Mayor Durrell's leadership and yours as well has left this government a lot better, in a lot better condition than we found it 12 years ago. There are some challenges ahead, but I think we've all set the table for some really progressive things to be done as we move forward, and we look forward to you guys carrying the torch.
Mr. Castillo?
Well, yes, the last 8 years have been interesting. It's been a pretty good ride for myself, a former employee of this government. Came in as the underdog, and I still remember that meeting I had with Mr. Durel and Mr. Stanley in their office. They were shaking their head no, I was shaking my head yes.
So why you want to go there?
I'm coming, and I arrived. But I enjoyed the last 8 years. I learned a lot. Joe has done good for Lafayette. His administration did well. Of course, the council did awesome. I mean, our guys, you know, we carry the water a lot. And me and Kenneth, I think we did a pretty good job together. Pretty much like you and Mr. Stanley, Mr. Durrell did.
You sure it was water in that bucket, sir?
Sometimes I wonder. But I enjoyed the last 8 years. It really was a learning experience for me. I enjoyed
it. You're
here. Like Mr. Castillo, the last 8 years have been challenging for the administration in this council, but also like Mr. Stanley, I agree that we've left it in a much better condition than we found it. As a man and as a council member, I often grapple with the fact, do you want someone to like you or do you want someone to respect you? And although I prefer respect, I will tell you, Joy, I like you as a person and I respect you as a man. Good luck to you in your future and everything you do going forward.
Well said, Mr. Chair. Well said.
All righty.
Stoops, I mean, am I missing something?
D got back. If only Joey could get a unanimous vote of the council one time. Dee, the election's over. Come on up here.
Donnie, in my book, you're about 6'4". It's great to be here. We actually did have a council meeting that ran to just a few minutes ago, and I hid out in the hallway because the video obviously didn't make much sense otherwise. And just to see the faces and look at the signatures and the notes on the poster outside, I know that's a treasure that Joey will keep forever. One of the things he said tonight earlier, because he was at that council meeting before he came here, is how much he valued and treasured the employees of our government. We often get a bad rap when you're dealing with 2,300 people. Sometimes people duck behind the trees to smoke a cigarette on company time, and you guys deal with that in the private sector. But in the end, we have a passionate group of people that will continue to carry on the vision, implement the strategy, and do the things that you don't think about when you turn on a light switch or drive to work or go to a movie theater. And I think it may have been Gary who, or Robert, or all of you, who said that there's something unique about Joey and his vision and who he is. And he just sees things that normal people don't see. And it's been a real treasure for me. We've developed, as you might guess, an incredible friendship. Our families are close. I won't miss him because we vowed to keep the breakfast club that we do every Friday. But to Cherry and Steve and our friends at The Independent for putting this together, what a great send-off for somebody that history will regard as the greatest mayor that we've had in Lafayette. He's my friend. I love him, and it's been incredible to work with him.
Thank you, Dee. Those were very kind words, but what do you think about Joey? Well, you weren't talking about me? For a final send-off, we have the, what do we call them? The Indie Media Carolers. And we ask you to accompany us on your table. Should I tell them about the envelope?
I will in a minute.
Okay.
Well, to close out, there are many things that you can say about Joey Durel. Most of them have been said here tonight already, but there are a couple of final words we'd like to add. Thank you, Joey, for always being willing to return phone calls from those of us in the media, even when you were peeved about something, for keeping an open and even-handed relationship with all of us in the media and never threatening to cut off channels of communication, even if we were working on a story that you didn't like. That's courage and that's true leadership. That's the way democracy is supposed to work, and it's made this a better place for media and for all of the citizens of Lafayette as well. Thanks, too, for being such a good sport, like when you posed for this poster, which was actually the cover of the first Cool Town issue that we ever did at The Independent. And also, on the next slide, when you agreed to go mano a mano with our contributing writer, Dej Legg, in his popular series, Post Haste. Post Haste is a series of off-the-wall Q&As that could only come from Dej, like this one. Do you ever get the urge to throw a lit pack of firecrackers into Dee Stanley's office and run down the hall? The answer, yes, and it was awesome. Here's another one of Deej's questions. What was the strangest or most out of place thing another politician or business leader ever said to you while on the job? Durel says, correct me if I'm right, but, or this one. History of Joey Durel in five words or less. Your answer, born bald, ending up bald. Actually, that bald thing is quite a theme in your tenure as city parish president. When we did the recent Star Trek-inspired cover of you and Terry Uval, I asked you how you liked it. And your comment, it was great, but if you're going to Photoshop the cover, why couldn't you give me some hair? Well, here's why. Because it wouldn't look anything like you. But since you won't have us to give you hair anymore, we have a little do-it-yourself hair kit so you can do it yourself. So it's not as nice as T. Joe's rope, but it is a toupee. I'll give it to you later. So we hope you enjoyed the song that we have prepared for you. So the audience, on your table, there's an envelope that says, "Don't open until Christmas or until we tell you." So if you'd like to sing along, it's to the tune of Jingle Bells. I would like to ask the Deck the Halls, excuse me. I'd like to ask the media, the in media carolers and friends to come up by the microphones, please. Please welcome our singing leaders tonight. So grab your lyrics and sing along.
Deck the mayor down in Broussard, annex everything for Lafayette. Thwart the old South Side Tea Party, trade the Buick for a red Corvette. Don me now a righteous toothache, squirrel on head, squirrel on head, squirrel on head. Sleeping late and driving crazy, try to be a little less white bread. Cut a secret deal with Dago, make a prank call to Robodeau. Send a letter to Chris Williams, tell the so-and-so where to go. Don me now a righteous toupee, squirrel on head, squirrel on head, squirrel on head. Promise D I'll call him often, but I'll block his number instead. Pick a fight with Brandon Shelvin, get my kickback from River Ranch. Jared Bellard needs a Melvin and a whooping with an olive branch. Don me now a righteous toupee, squirrel on head, squirrel on head, squirrel on head. Make the new year really awesome, for the Joey gospel I will spread.
Joey, you've been a good sport, and in every roast, the roastee gets a chance to retort. And so we now have 30 seconds. And because we're running over time, it might only be 15. But come on up and say whatever you want to say. Thank you.
I don't want to ruin my image now, after all this. I want to say, I don't know what I want to say.
You want to sit on the chair?
No, not your chair, for sure. You know, on days that it's your birthday, it should all be about you. So I would like to ask Bradley Shaston to stand up. And everybody, happy birthday to Bradley. On any other December 15th, we'd be out to dinner right now. So, surprise! By the way, if you remember in 2007, there was a Marquis de Lafayette celebration and raised some money, private dollars, not tax dollars. And it turns out we have a little bit of money left in there. And so the Marquis de Lafayette Fund, with the help of Lynn, who is the co-chair of that, and Maisie Movasagi, who is on it, they convinced Philippe and the rest of the group to donate the final $8,000, almost $9,000, for tonight. So, Carolyn, another eight. Thank you. So that's another $16,000. You know, Don, there was a there was something I remember said years ago when I got something and Matt Stella was the MC. Is Matt still here? Or did he leave before it even started? And I read something about MCs and they said, you know, the MC should be very sort of bland, kind of boring. You know, you shouldn't really come anywhere close to dominating anything and being in the spotlight. So to Cherry, y'all picked the perfect one. So thank y'all. Ben, you know, one of the things that was very intimidating for me was Ben did quit a good job. He quit a job with Coca-Cola as a young man. I mean, that's you know, and we came back from Building Community Conference, I think. We were already in the race, and Jason came up to me, my daughter, Jason, and he he said, Dad, he said, you know, Jason and Ben were in school together. Ben was a year ahead of him, and he said, I think you ought to talk to Ben Berthelot about managing your campaign. I said, well, Jason, I said, he's got a job. He's got a good job, you know, for a young guy. I mean, it's a big company. And he said, I think you ought to talk to him. He said, I think he'd be interested. So I did. And Ben quit that job. And I thought, whew, you know, that's really, you know, it's intimidating in a way. And you realize that you had, you know, somebody whose life was really dependent on your work. And but I'll never forget, you know, who called him up, hippie or something like that? I'll never forget Bobby Cormier and Ben and I were heading to Baton Rouge one day, and Bobby was driving. I was in the front seat, and Ben's in the back seat. And I saw Bobby glance in the rearview mirror, and he had this kind of inquisitive look in his eyes, and he said, Ben, he said, did you mess your hair up different today? And so between he and Pat Ottinger competing with who didn't wear socks brought a whole different look to our administration. So, but Ben, another thing that's an interesting story about the campaign, I'll never forget somebody came up to us and said, Joey, he said, you realize there's this thing you can get that during the day of the election, you can actually go to the polling, to the precincts, and you can email back how the vote's going. I said, really? I said, what is it called? He said, it's called a BlackBerry. And that was just 2003. And so I immediately almost got Ben and I a BlackBerry. And once we got elected, I told Dee, I said, every director's got to have one of these. And I think Terry's still using his. You know? But Ben, thank you. Seriously, I mean, it's for you to have done what you did, and I will tell you, it is extremely gratifying to me to see how you've risen and you've earned every bit of it. So congratulations to you, and thank you. Terry, you know, we call Terry the $250,000 man. it's just got that ring to it. Heck, I don't have to say anything else. Thank you. Thank you, Terry. But, no, Terry, it was an interesting visit, and I'll never forget that day we visited, and the birth of fiber. And I will tell you, Terry has made some amazing sacrifices. So to all of you in this room that have supported fiber and supported this community, because it's making a difference in this community and it will continue to make a difference in this community, thank you. And Terry, thank you. You worked hard. You know, roasts are where people like Robert Daigle come in and exaggerate, and others come in and tell lies. And I got to thinking, I thought, what a perfect forum for newspapers to sponsor. You know, because they do make it up as they go. And in fact, I have kind of decided that one of the things I may do is become a newspaper reporter and focus on quantum physics, because I know nothing about that, so it ought to make me a perfect reporter. But I do want to thank the newspapers for what you've done something for Lynn and I that you would never be aware of if we didn't have this kind of an opportunity. I heard some great advice from one of the great people of our community, Paul Hilliard, years ago. And Paul made a comment about the newspapers and said, you know, he tries to read one of our local newspapers every night because he's assured of going to bed with absolutely nothing on his mind. And so Lynn and I, for several years now, have had a routine where we read one of your articles every night and we sleep great. So thank you all for that. Robert, Robert Richie Ranch, the amount I got beat up on the radio show about Richie Ranch, the hell you caused me, and I had nothing to do. I mean, I was so innocent. We know y'all don't flood. You know, we've fixed all the flooding. We sent it out in the parish. And y'all have no issues, no problems whatsoever, and you're welcome. But I will say this, and I've told Robert this story. You know, we've made a handful of trips to New York on what we call bond rating trips. Go to there and try to sell Lafayette and get our bond ratings down, our credit ratings, or I should say our credit ratings up, bond ratings down. And I'll never forget one of the trips we went on. The first rating agency that came in to visit with us in the room we were set up in started talking about, she came in and one of the ladies said, I just read something about Lafayette, Louisiana, that y'all have more restaurants per capita than any other city in America. I said, I don't know if it's true, but we'll take it. You know, I think it's a good thing for us to exaggerate about or whatever. So, but then she said, I read something about this place called River Ranch. And we started talking about River Ranch. And we spent a lot of time talking about River Ranch. And it became a big part of the conversation. And so after it went really well with that, the next agency that came in, I steered towards talking about River Ranch. So I got to tell you, when I've had people call me who hadn't grown up yet and call on the radio show, you know, and somehow, and I'd say, I just have to ask the question, would your life be better off today if River Ranch had developed in Arkansas? You know, so thank y'all. You know, we appreciate your investment. We appreciate the risk you took. And I hope y'all have nothing but continued success. Y'all have meant a lot to Lafayette, we've used you often as selling Lafayette, and it's made a big difference for us. T. Joe, I thought Kappa Sig was an academic organization. You joined it. I mean, I assumed it had to be, so I joined it too, you know. Gary, you are the whitest black man I've ever met in my life. You know, Gary is one of the 1,400 black men in Lafayette. And, you know, I'll never forget talking to one of our minority councilmen, and he talked about, don't laugh, Greg. Where's Greg? No, not you. Not you. I want the other Greg. Where's Greg? Don't laugh. Because one of the councilmen one time told me, he said something about the two white guys and the 100 black men. I said, there's two? I said, I thought it was only Gary. He said, no, the other one's Greg Davis. You figured that one out, huh? Now, this is not really a roast, but it will be taken as a roast, and that is a person who doesn't get nearly the credit, doesn't want any of the credit, doesn't want any of the spotlight, hates it, I'm in trouble already, is my wife, Lynn. I have been scared to death about this moment all day because she does not like it. But in 12 years, I have not given her the kind of credit publicly that she deserves. She's gotten some, you know, the woman thing recently in one of the magazines? Woman of the Year a few years ago. But I mean, Lynn has worked very, very hard and has been extremely supportive and has trained me for several years now. And what Ben said was exactly right. I'd get in the car, my phone would start vibrating. I said, oh God, it was Lynn. And I knew, I mean, I kind of knew when I say stupid things on the radio, you know, sometimes I do it on purpose. And then I'd walk into the office, of course, and Dee would be waiting. I'd say, don't even say anything, Lynn's already called. But Lynn has, you can imagine, you know, you're dealing with family issues and grandkids and all the things that happen in anybody else's life. And she's got to deal with some of the crazy things I would do or say. And some of them, like I said, you know, you do it to motivate people one way or the other, whatever it takes. And but Lynn, thank you. I know you have been my greatest supporter, and sometimes it, you know, necessarily so a critic of in a way to help me be better, but you deserve an awful lot and another great big round of applause. So thank you. That's it. I just want to thank you. You know, this 12 years has been great. I see some of my staff sitting over here. Catherine, I guess Carly hasn't even made it back from the council meeting, huh? Sidra, Becky, y'all have been great. You know, y'all have, as I've said often, the most important job of this position is to surround yourself with great people. And y'all have done it, and I get to get the credit, but y'all have done all the work, and thank y'all very much for everything. We have, you want me to leave? Is that it? Is that a hint? Well, thank y'all all very much. You know, this is one of the things that obviously I'm extremely passionate about is the horse farm. I truly, truly, sincerely believe that the horse farm poses an opportunity for us to have, for it to have a, to be a game changer for Lafayette. And I really mean that because I see what we're competing with. I see the cities around the country, around the world that we compete with. And I've gotten to see a lot of the world thanks to you very much. And I appreciate that. But we are competing and we don't have to, you know, it's much, I can tell you as a politician, for D&I, for those of us that have done what we've done for the last 12 years, it would be very easy not to compete. Very, very easy. You know, you don't have to stick your necks out for developments on a Louisiana Avenue, for a huge development like Costco coming in. You know, you don't have to do those kind of things, but they make a difference. And if we're not, you know, we see what's happening in the oil and gas industry. You know, those are all things, while retail may not typically be huge economic development for the people that are working there, it's pretty important economic development. And the fact that we depend so much on sales taxes in Lafayette, bringing people in, a Costco will bring people in from a much wider radius. And if they're coming from farther away, they will spend more time in Lafayette and shop at a lot of other stores and give people something, a reason to spend time in Lafayette. But again, as I said, you know, We've taken the risks, and fiber was one of those big risks. But the horse farm, I still say the horse farm is one of those things. And I'll say this. My father, who died a couple of years ago, I know for sure the horse farm was what he was most proud of, for sure. And I told Terry, because I know every time somebody says, Joey, the horse farm is your legacy or whatever else, Terry's singing, damn, what about all the stuff we've done with fiber? And I agree. But like I told Terry, I said, you know, Terry, in 100 years from now, when fiber is something people giggle about that technology that we used to have way back then, I said, the trees at the horse farm are just gonna be 100 years older and more prettier. You know, I mean, it's not gonna get antiquated. It's not going to go away. It's only going to get better with age, it's one of those things. Like I said, that as we're Greg, T. Joe, when we sit in these rooms with these people, you know, I got to tell you, I don't hear a lot of talk about taxes. I mean, maybe you get into some of that detail, but it's about quality of life. It's about where their employees are going to work. It's about the safety of the community. It's about a lot of things that are not as technical as you might think. I mean, they deal with that, but they want to know where their employees, what kind of life they're going to have. And I think when we start trying to bring companies in here that can keep your kids here, that can keep our grandkids here, the horse farm is going to play a huge role in not just for Lafayette, not just for Lafayette Parish, but for all of Acadiana. It makes a difference. And so thank you all for tonight. Cherry, Judy, thank you all very much, despite your last 12 years. And y'all have, actually, you talked about I returned the phone calls. I didn't really always return the phone calls. I put some people in timeout every now and then. But, you know, I'm still a boy. I can pout like anybody else. But thank you all very much tonight. Good night. And I really do appreciate it. And Don, I appreciate you finishing it out and sticking with us. Whatever that means.
Joey, thank you. That's enough. He won't be able to fit the toupee on. There was a presidential candidate that asked this question: are you better off today than you were 4 years ago? I think all of us can say truthfully, we're better off today than we were 12 years ago. And Joey's an awful big reason for us being able to say that. Woody talked about the horse farm. He talked about a vision, a legacy, something that we can leave behind for our kids. And Kip and Carolyn graciously have donated $500,000 that we need to match. There's another $500,000 that one of our board members put up also as a challenge, for a total of $1 million, as Lenny was saying. If we can raise $1 million, we can fund $2 million for the horse farm. So I ask all of you to think in this season of giving, that if you can't, maybe give a little bit to the horse farm. And those of you that are rich, and many of you out there are, maybe you can give a lot. I thank you all for coming. I thank Cherry and Steve for putting this on. I thank Joey for being a wonderful mayor president. And I thank you all for making Lafayette the place that it is. Thank you.